देखो आगे।
Ma'am, you can start now.
Okay. So good evening, everyone. Sorry, our due apologies for starting a little late due to the weather and the server issues. We'll welcome Professor V.L. Gupta once again. He is professor from NITR. So as they say, research is the foundation of education. Research is a pillar on which the entire education system is lying. And today we have with us Professor V.L. Gupta to tell us that how we can integrate research into our pedagogical tools for teaching management students and also in the area of technical education. So I'll without taking much more time, I'll invite Professor V.L. Gupta to please kindly enlighten our participants. They have been waiting, sir.
Good evening, everyone. I want to thank again the management of the host institute. I want to thank the director, the coordinator, and co-coordinator of this webinar. Short-term training program. And if you permit, I think we missed the day before yesterday, the last part of project-based learning. So if you permit, I think I can throw light on that, and after that we move to the research. Would it be better, Professor Ghosh?
Yes, sir. Let me start. Okay.
Can I take that last part?
Yes, sir. This is the fifth part.
Fifth part, yes. Yeah. Dear friends, are you able to see it, sir?
Yes, sir.
Presentation?
Yeah, it is. Achha,
you have started. Okay, yeah. Great. So, dear colleagues, dear friends, on project-based learning, we had a lot of interaction day before yesterday. We started with the importance of project-based learning from outcome-based point of view, from outcome-based education point of view, and from accreditation requirement point of view. So in the first presentation, we have appreciated the concept of importance of project-based learning, Then we moved to the concept of project-based learning in the changed scenario. Then we talked about characteristics of project-based learning. Then in the second part, we talked about purposes of project-based learning for the students and for the teachers. Similarly, we have also appreciated the type of learning produced by the project-based learning, that is main learning, associated learning, and I think you can recall third one, that is process-related learning. After that, I have also taken some examples of titles of the project, and after that we moved to the third presentation, that was on preparing guideline document at institute level for project-based learning and problem-based learning. Then in the fourth part, we have discussed the assessment scheme, and in the assessment scheme we have appreciated in the third part, along with guideline document, is a project guide how to manage the students' projects, learning projects, and we have also appreciated the importance of having monitoring schedule. Then in the fourth part, I discussed the total assessment scheme for project-based learning from outcome-based education point of view. And in the assessment scheme, we have appreciated the concept that the complete assessment scheme must be incorporated in the guideline document, and this scheme should be uniformly followed across the departments and across the programs. Then I talked about the tools, assessment tools, which are predominantly used in problem-based learning and in project-based learning. Then I also talked about the assessment techniques. Having done that, we have also appreciated the new concept of self-assessment, peer assessment, teacher assessment, expert assessment, and one more was there, I think, for certification, the examiner assessment. After having discussed that, I think there was some problem on my end related to connectivity, so I could not do the last part. So dear friends, again today also there were some technical problems because of the server, but no issue, this is the life, and this is how we remove hurdles, we remove obstacles, and we progress. So in this presentation, I welcome all of you, and in this presentation I want to relate the project-based learning and problem-based learning with the outcome-based learning. Sorry, project-based learning and problem-based learning with outcome-based education and accreditation requirement. This will also ensure the quality of education at program level. Sorry, at course level, program level, and department level and institute level. So having done that, now we have to see the relevance of the project-based learning and problem-based learning. Although I have not talked about problem-based learning, but that is the part of project-based learning. Dear friends, there may be an obvious question in your mind, what is the difference between the problem-based learning and project-based learning? It is simply the magnitude. That's it. Before I take up this, I also want to share that project-based learning integrates the learning of all courses of a particular program, and it creates opportunities to apply the learning of all courses in world of work situation. That is very important and significant point in project-based learning. The another point is that since the project-based learning is created for real life problems. So there is an opportunity for thinking to think, or in other words, there is an opportunity for creativity. So students are encouraged to think differently so that they come out with alternatives or better solutions or something means innovative and different, maybe strategy or approach or whatever. It all depends on the topic. We have also appreciated that project-based learning develops learning in all three domains of learning, that is cognitive domain, affective domain, and psychomotor domain. We have also appreciated that project-based learning develops all types of abilities which have been listed in self-assessment report, especially for engineering, management, pharmacy programs, and hotel management programs. Similarly, NAIC has also formulated the POs, so certainly it will contribute there also. So with this, I think we can have the last presentation, the relevance of project-based learning with accreditation. So may I request Professor Ghosh to present that fifth presentation, to project that fifth presentation.
Sir, it is already on.
No, here it is, webinar outcome is coming.
Okay. Project-based learning, are you observing, sir?
No, this one is only welcome one. Encompasses okay. all the parts of the, it's the, what do you call, advanced organizer. The last one, if you have, I think you can.
Five.
So other day, dear friends, I was talking to you that there are 100 points which the program may fetch if the program implements the project-based learning systematically, scientifically, and professionally. And dear friends, only we people are responsible for this. Means we can make a difference since we produce the learning in students. So let me share this PPT with you. If I talk about direct link of project-based learning with NBA accreditation, if you refer the self-assessment report, there are activities related to curricular gap and content beyond syllabus, and which can be very well established through project-based learning. This is 2.1.2 of self-assessment report of undergraduate programs. Similar things are available in other self-assessment reports in criterion 2, I think. And 10 points are there. So if it is done properly at institute level in a systematic manner, you can get 10 points. Then quality of students' projects can be established. 25 marks are there. Again, it is a direct link. It is for the project-based learning only. So if you do it and if you keep the evidences, you can get 25 marks. Then coming to the third point, that is innovation. Innovations made by faculty members in teaching learning process. So if at institute level you have guideline document and everything, and you have proper orientation of all teachers, if you have proper systems and processes, if you have proper assessment schemes, if you have well-designed assessment tools and techniques, I think you can document this experience and you can put on your website for sharing purpose and for receiving the comments of others, means the fellow professionals, professional teachers, and you get 20 marks for this particular innovation. So in this way, you get 55 points for only project-based method, that is directly. Now coming to the next one, that is indirect link. Process followed to improve the teaching learning. Again here, since you are following student-centric teaching learning method, so you will get some points. Then publication, this is very important, dear friends. Many teachers come to me and they ask me how to publish and what to publish. So only conceptual papers will not serve the purpose. Conceptual papers are good to initiate the thinking on a particular dimension of a particular situation, but they have lowest value in publication. So every year, for every batch, you have 10 to maybe 15 major projects. If you are able to convert these projects into research paper, or maybe in the form of a case study, or maybe in the form of a review of a particular strategy or technology or method or technique or like that, you can publish the paper. And it may be a joint publication also. And the beauty of this publication is that it is based on the preliminary data, primary data. Not preliminary, it is based on the primary data. Means your students and you have worked on something and you came to a particular conclusion. So these types of papers are considered to be very good for publication. So any standard journal will accept the papers. So I was referring that the publication may be a joint. So for students' publication, there is a point in the accreditation process. Similarly, for faculty members' publications, there are points in the accreditation. So you may get, you may fetch points under publication criteria, sub-criterion also. Then there are many institutions who have project laboratory or who can establish project laboratory, maybe through sponsorship or maybe through collaboration, or it may be a joint venture or maybe through government funding. And if you do that, for that also there are points in the accreditation process. Then continuous improvement. In NBA accreditation process, this is one of the important criteria to award accreditation to the program. So the team sees whether there is a continuous improvement in last 5 years, 3 years or not. And in continuous improvement, there is a provision for action taken. So projects can be used as action taken for continuous improvement. And here also you can claim some points out of 50 or 75 points. Then improvement in placement. This is very important, and on my first presentation, I shared my experience that the whole placement interview may be based on the project of the student, if it is innovative, if it is new, and if it is aligned to the core business of the recruiter or employer. And not only placement, but better package may also be obtained if the project is novel, new, different, and unique. And in NBA accreditation also, there is a provision for points under this. Then assessment, the sixth indirect link is, that is 8.4 of self-assessment report. And there also, you can get points because you are using variety of tools and techniques like checklist, rating scale, observation sheet, interview schedule, rubric, and like. So you get points under assessment scheme also. So this is how you get near about 10% marks or points out of 1,000 points. So if all teachers work on this particular philosophy of problem-based learning and project-based learning, definitely you may fetch up to 95 points or even 100 points if it is properly designed, implemented, documented, and presented in front of NBA team. Now coming to the last part, last slide, how to select the project title. Dear friends, we all have been guiding projects of the students, but in outcome-based education, the title or problem or situation or theme or issue for project-based learning is selected in a different way. So I think you are able to see this table. The project title one, I have mentioned here, upgradation of Pancham Ki Fail. This was my BE title. So this was in traditional and conventional teaching. Now I have to add, if you can recall the POs of your program. So now I have to add something which is related to PO and PSO. So upgradation of Pancham Ki Fail, considering environmental, sustainability, and economic aspects, like that. So that it covers more number of POs. What I want to submit here, that now we are coming out from domain-specific articulation of project problem, and we are trying to incorporate consciously and directly the interdisciplinary aspects and other aspects which are the requirement of the program outcomes. So in this way, what do we do? For a particular batch, we list out all the 10, 12, 15 project titles, and we have already talked about it. These titles may be chosen by the teacher. These titles may be selected by the students themselves, and there may be a negotiation. But before allocating the project titles to the students, we should list out all the project titles here in column 2, project titles here. Then we should do the mapping of each title with the PO and PSO. So dear friends, here you can see that this particular title, upgradation of Pancham Ki Fail, considering environmental and sustainability and economic aspects, is mapped at low level with PO1, substantial level with PO2 and 3, moderate level with PO4. It is not mapped with the PO5 and 6, and so on and so forth. So in this way, we map all the titles before allocating the project titles to the students. So what we have done, we have completed this matrix or this table. Now we will see in a departmental group that whether there is 1-3 in each row or not. If 1-3 is there in each row, if 1-3 is there, it means at least 1-3 is there, it means the project title is strong and direct. It is a significant title to be undertaken by the students. If there is no 3 in any one of the column in this particular row, it means project title needs revision. So what I want to submit here, that each project title must contribute substantially for at least one PO. That is why in each row there should be at least 1-3. Similarly, since I have completed the table, now I am coming to the PO. So in each program outcome means one column. So in this column, there should be at least 1-3. If 1-3 is not there in any of the columns, it means that particular PO is not properly mapped. So in that case, we should try to modify or refine or fine-tune the project titles so that PO is mapped at 3 level means substantial level are at 3 level. This is the concept of mapping which is used in NBA. 3 means substantial mapping, 2 means moderate mapping, and 1 means slight mapping. So I'm not saying that each title must map with all 12 POs and PSOs, no. But I am saying that each title must map at substantial level with at least one PO. It's like that. So dear friends, the thumb rule is that each row must have 1-3, means substantial level, and each column must have at least 1-3. So this is how we finalize the project titles for a batch of students, and then we assign the titles to different groups. So this is how we select the project title. So with this, I want to conclude that project-based learning is a student-centric method, and using this method, you enhance the maturity level of the students, and you make them active, and you make them learn and think creatively. And this method is very good for developing creative as well as logical skills in our students at higher level. So with this, I close this presentation, and now I am coming to you for responding to your questions, or maybe hearing from you about your experiences related to project-based learning. So I am with you, sir. Sirs and madams.
Sir, yet we have not received any question.
Give 1 minute time. Give 30 seconds time. 1 minute time. You will
get some questions. Will be,
yeah, they will be typing. So it may take 30 seconds to 1 minute. Or you can ask for unmute also, and in a disciplined way, you can take up the question, no issue.
So first question from Geeta Dasmana. How we give project to special needs children? Can you get my question?
Yeah. Again, we have to see the type of special needs and all that. I'm just thinking, I have not given thought to this dimension of project-based learning. Yeah, considering their strengths, they are having weaknesses, but at the same time, they have some strengths. So considering that, the project can be allocated. But I think we are having a mixed group. We are working on a principle of inclusive education. So that fellow may be clubbed with other persons. So it may be a good team of students to take up a project. They help each other. I don't know, actually. I haven't seen project-based learning from this point of view. This point of view.
Sir, what we can do, I think everybody, another question is there from Geeta ma'am itself. If we talk about the inclusive education, then how it is applicable?
Which one applicable? Project-based learning.
Inclusive education. If we talk about the inclusive education.
Yeah, we we work in limitations. So Government of India took a decision to have concept of inclusive education, where we have, means we as a faculty member and the colleagues of the students, they take care of each and everything of each other. So considering the type of the limitation, the faculty member should, means, plan the instruction and deliver the instructions and like that. And the institutes may also facilitate through technology or maybe through assistant or like that.
So I think as the program has been started late, it may happen that people are now waiting for the research techniques.
Okay.
Let me start with that, and at the end we can take all the questions if there is any question remain on project-based learning. Yeah. We will take there. Okay.
Okay, fine, fine.
So we are coming to your research studies.
Okay, fine. So are you going to make a presentation?
Right, sir.
Okay. Okay. So thank you all for giving me time on project-based learning. It's very close to my heart, and in future we have to work on project-based learning only. Now coming to the next title of the training program, STTP, that is research studies in technical or higher education. You can take it for both the systems. I am not very particular about technical, but I will deal with the technical and higher. I will not deal with the school education or maybe other education system, but whatever I will talk, it may be applicable to all types of systems. But how much it will be applicable, the magnitude may be less or more, that depends on the context and situation. So research is very, very important, and especially we in our country, especially the faculty members, are primarily responsible for conducting the research studies. But our experience is that most of the faculty members conduct research studies for their postgraduate programs or for pursuing PhD. And some of the faculty members conduct research studies for generating revenue for their institute. But still, the research culture has to come in our country. And that is why the system, the education system, is based on perceptions, views, experiences, preferences, and the like, whether it is at the national level or state level or at institute level or maybe at teacher level. So we don't have, what do you call, proper philosophies for dealing different situations. So I simply want to focus on that. There are, what are the purposes of research studies in technical and higher education? So these are some of the purposes I have listed, and these purposes I have listed based on my experiences. Dear friends, I'm not going to talk about theory, since we all are professors and we have formally undergone research methodology and statistics course during our education, or maybe during conducting project work at PG level or maybe at PhD level. So to diagnose the problems of the system and generate solution means the problem should not occur repeatedly. Why the problems are occurring repeatedly? Because we are dealing with the problems superficially. We don't have perfect system for preventing the problems. So if we have proper research system at any level, maybe national level, state level, institute level, maybe at course level, so we can diagnose the problem properly. And if we are able to diagnose the problem, we can generate the solution. And we should generate the solution in such a way so that that problem should not occur in our life. So it may be a problem-solving approach. It may be problem-solving approach using research approach like that. But the purpose here is to diagnose the problem and to come out with a solution which removes the problem from its roots. Then to improve the quality of inputs, processes, and outputs. Dear friends, in my 37 years of career, I have seen that people are crying for the resources, maybe manpower, maybe money, maybe material, maybe machines, maybe time, minutes. But on the other hand, I see not many resources are not being used properly. The utilization factor is 8%, 7%, even less than 1% in many organizations. And it is because of many reasons. But nobody wants to analyze those reasons, analyze those causes, and wants to come out with a proper system. So if we have proper well-researched strategies, then these types of problems will not come, and we can increase, we can enhance the utilization factor in our institute or in our state or maybe in our country. So from that point of view, research studies are very, very important. I'm not saying that each and every problem requires research studies. That we have already discussed in four quadrant approach. To design and implement innovations, this is very important in 21st century. Everything is changing very fast, especially the external environment. And there is a need to change the internal environment accordingly. And this requires a lot of research so that we are in tune with the world of work situation with the external environment. Rather, I always promote that we should lead the change, not the outer world should lead the change. So we should be able to come out with the models, tools, techniques, strategies, theories, concepts, principles, laws, like that, through research. It is also required to compare the performance of maybe different states or maybe different institutions or maybe different individuals or maybe different students, different classes like that. So that is also not there. Then coming to the next one, to evaluate the impact of the change or innovation. We invest a lot of resources in change management and in implementing interventions, but we never see what was the impact of that particular change or intervention. So that impact evaluation will give us many guidelines for designing new changes in the future. So every time same experience we are repeating, because we don't have any data-based concept, principles, and all that. Then to develop research abilities. This is also very important. A good teacher should be a good learner and should be a good researcher also, so that you have analytical as well as creative abilities, which will get reflected in your teaching learning process and which will get transferred to students. You can create environment of that sort in your institute. And to generate evidence-based policy. Right now, a committee is constituted, maybe at institute level or state level, and based on the deliberations of that particular committee, the policy decisions are made. And in reality, we see what is the implication and impact of those policy decisions. Many times they are not relevant also. So if we conduct the research studies, definitely we can draft evidence-based policies. So these are some of the purposes of having research in technical and higher education. Now coming to the next part, that is types of studies. So dear friends, you all are familiar with the types of studies, means which is classified in research books and which are classified in different disciplines: fundamental or basic, applied, experimentation, these, that. There are many ways of classification. I'm not going to touch that classification, but I am interested in types of study which may be undertaken in technical and higher education. So impact study, we can see the impact of the curriculum, we can see the impact of the teaching learning process, we can see the impact of the examination system, we can see the impact of guidance and counseling, we can see the impact of entrepreneurship development programs. So we should have, or we should conduct small impact studies at national level, or maybe at state level, or maybe at institute level, or maybe at course level. So if you change the strategy, what is the impact of that, like that? Second one is tracer study. We have been producing batches of students, but we don't trace their profile. Where they are working, how they are working, what are their accomplishments, what innovations and changes they have implemented in their parent organization. There are so many aspects of tracing the pass outs of the institute. So we can undertake tracer study also. These tracer studies help us to revise and fine tune the career, and at the same time to get better employment for our students. These studies built up our image also. The institute image is built up based on the profile of the pass outs, and this can be done through tracer study. Then need analysis. Generally, an idea comes in the mind of a person who is empowered to take decision, and the idea is implemented. And after that, we come to know that lot of resources have been wasted and nothing has happened. So if we do need analysis, and on the basis of that, if we design the interventions, or means we design the plans or strategies, it would be better. So we can minimize the, or we can prevent the wastage of resources, and we don't waste waste our time and effort, and we don't create frustration and demotivation for implementers. Then diagnostic studies, they are also very important. You have been doing well, but what is the wrong with the plan? What is the wrong with the strategy? So you can do diagnostic study. Then descriptive study, I think this is very very similar to the studies which we do in business, commerce, engineering, and all that. Then content analysis. Again, this is very, very important. A good teacher should be a good content analyzer. And if you are able to analyze the content properly, then you will deliver the content in totality with respect to outcome. Otherwise, there will be many gaps, and the complete learning will not take place. So content analysis is a very good research method for designing the curriculum, for implementing the curriculum, for designing the assessment system. It is a very good tool. And for teachers, it is a very good tool for designing the learning material. Suppose you want to write a textbook or reference book, or suppose you want to develop video programs, or suppose you want to shoot the industrial practices and you want to create video sessions. Suppose you want to develop multimedia package. For that, content analysis is very, very important. Then SNAP study. Whatever you are doing, what is the result of that? How it is going on? That is called SNAP study. So we should also conduct a SNAP study so that we are well aware about our happenings. Then coming to the profile study. We don't have profile study of teachers of higher education in our India. What is the profile? We don't know. At country level or at state level or maybe at institute level. Nobody has worked on the profile of the teachers. So we should be able to maintain the profile. If we are able to maintain the profile, we can tape their strengths and we can grab the opportunities. And at the same time, if something is missing in the profile, that can be fulfilled. So things don't become casual and decisions don't become ad hoc. Then comparative study. There are number of purposes of taking up comparative studies, and these are used for accreditation purpose, for motivation purpose, for evaluation purpose, for diagnosing the problem purpose, for changing the strategy purpose, at all levels, whether institute, department, teacher, student, whatever. Then these types of studies, experimental studies, they have become very important in today's context. Since we all are initiating and we are implementing outcome-based education philosophy, so can we do experimentation? Number of concepts are coming up every day: blended learning, technology-enabled learning, collaborative learning, cooperative learning, flipped class are evolving every day. But in our own context, which basket of concepts will work? So we can do a small experimentation and we can come to conclusion that within the limit of our vision and our culture and our values, this basket of concepts will work. Excuse me. Then coming to the case study. A case study is also a very good method, and it has been popular. Surprisingly, it has been popular in the field of agriculture. But in other fields, it has not percolated down. So as a teacher, we can study a case. It may be a typical case, maybe related to peculiar case in our institute, related to student, related to teacher. Then coming to action research, if you want to build up and develop your institute, and if you want to develop a conducive culture and climate in the institute, if you want to innovate, if you want to adopt technology and techniques, if you want to do something new, different and innovative in your functioning, I think action research is always encouraged. And in developed countries, at institute level, many of the people or many of the faculty members are collectively doing the action research, so that everybody is planning same thing and moving in right direction and sharing the experiences and challenging their traditional practices or the practice which has been implemented, and adding value to the practice and again implementing and again sharing like that. So the whole organization is learning in a particular context, and they are challenging their existing practices and they are adding value to it. So action research is a very, very strong and powerful research methodology to improve the performance of the organization and processes of the organization as a whole. And since we deal with the social beings, means human beings, so these types of research studies are very powerful and strong, but very few institutions are undertaking it. I have an experience of conducting this type of research study on quality circles. So I implemented quality circles in eight states of the country, and in three institutions of each state. And the results were wonderful. These were implemented in technical education system, and we used action research approach, which was blended, which was infused with the quality circle. So everybody learned, we also learned, teachers learned, students learned, and a kind of conducive and favorable environment was created in the institute. Then survey, it is also a popular method. And nowadays, technological tools are available. So you simply create a Google form and collect data. So at least you have something for taking the decision or designing something or like that. Means you are not talking in air. You are not talking with your preferences, but you are considering the views of many people. So these are the variety of methods which may be undertaken by teachers and at institute level or state level. And in this way, you can contribute for improving the quality of the education and for improving the image of the education system, whether it is technical or higher education system. So, and the beauty is that you will learn many things. So suppose you are decision maker or you take up the responsibility at higher level, that time it will be very much useful to you since you have all abilities. So these are the types of the methods. There could be many more also. Especially in outcome-based education, these are the surveys which are expected by the accreditation agencies. And in NBA accreditation, all these surveys are must. And for this survey, there are points. So NEET survey, course exit survey, graduate exit survey, alumni survey, employer survey, industry survey, and profile survey. These types of profile survey is not required, but rest of the other surveys are required for accreditation purpose. So this should be properly designed, implemented, documented, and reported. And your decisions should be based on these types of surveys. Research instruments, you all are familiar. I will simply touch and go. Structured, semi-structured, open-ended questionnaires, interview schedules, theme for creativity or discussion, document analysis criteria. These are some of the instruments which are commonly used. Checklist, rating scale, observation schedule, rubric. These can be used in combination depending upon the title and theme of the research. Data collection techniques, interview, focus group discussion, meetings, workshops, discussions. These are the data collection techniques, and we can use the technology also. Dear friends, these tools are very good for conducting qualitative research studies. And there is a scarcity of qualitative research studies in our country. Only PhD scholars are doing research studies, qualitative research studies, and the other research studies are not available significantly. So I would always encourage that you should take up research studies using these types of tools. Then coming to the next observation, form filling, document analysis, you have Google Meet, Google Form, and there are number of other platforms which may be used. Now coming to the papers, this is my favorite topic. I always talk about it during my research programs. There are conceptual papers. So as a teacher, we conceive many concepts, but we don't elaborate them in the form of a concept paper. We don't use cognitive map or mind map, and we don't develop the paper on that. Dear friends, if academicians don't develop the concept, who will develop? The other persons are busy in implementation in world of work. So conceptual papers are required. So whenever any innovative, new, different, novel, unique, divergent concept comes in your mind related to your course or related to your discipline, I think you should develop a conceptual paper, and that paper should be published. And nowadays it has become very easy. You can put it on your website and people will definitely see it and offer their comments or suggestions or remarks or like that. So conceptual papers are very much essential, and all teachers, whenever many times concepts come in the mind, but we simply ignore them. So it is a premature death of a particular concept, which may be new for the whole world. If any concept comes in your mind, please try to prepare a conceptual paper and publish it. Long back in my mind, many concepts came, and I converted those concepts into papers and books, like academic audit. When accreditation system was not there, that time I wrote a book on academic audit, which is one step further to accreditation. Similarly, proactive counseling. We do the counseling in such a way so there is no problem at all like that, or we are able to prevent the problem. So this is how, whenever any concept comes, try to elaborate it and try to convert it into papers, publish it, and it may be possible that you publish 5-6 papers on that particular concept, and that becomes a textbook for a university. So you have given something new and different to the education. That is also a kind of knowledge creation. Although the validity and reliability may be limited, but yes, you have given something, some food for thinking to the whole world. Maybe in future somebody may conduct research on that and may take it further like that. Then paper based on literature review. Dear friends, many of our colleagues face many problems related to paper writing and paper publishing. But in the era of information technology, lot of literature is available. So one should be able to review the literature and should be able to see it from different perspective and may publish a paper. So nowadays, reports, papers, books, references, case studies are available, and you can refer them and you can publish the paper. Then paper based on secondary data. There are research studies which are being conducted by PhD scholars and PG scholars, and there are some research studies which are undertaken by government agencies also. So their reports are available. Based on that, you can prepare a paper with a different perspective and you can publish. And paper based on primary data, whatever experiences you have as a teacher, if you document these experiences with a purpose and systematically, you can prepare a paper on paper based on primary data. As a teacher, we teach 3, 4, 5 courses. And every day, we are in contact with the students. So it may be observational paper, it may be on behavior, it may be on anything. Approach of the students like that, and you can publish it. I'm not talking about domain-specific research studies here. I'm simply talking about education-related research studies here, although I have engineering background. Okay, then case studies. You dealt with one particular course for a semester and for 2-3 batches. Can you prepare a case study on your experiences, the strengths, shortcomings, weaknesses, opportunities, and can you put it on your website of your institute, or can you publish it like that? So these are the types of papers which you can publish. And I would request every one of you to do some research work for the improvement of the system, and please do publish the experiences based on the research. One more thing I'm forgetting. It came to my mind and I slipped it. Okay. Then coming to some examples. In our institute, we encourage research studies at international level and national level, and we support our faculty members with all types of resources, including guidance, mentoring, and solving their problems. This year, we have selected 17 research studies. 1 year has already been over, and the total time is 2 years. And I'm happy to share with you that we have published many papers, and we have developed many modules based on literature review and our experiences on these topics. So I will quickly go through. These are the current research studies which are going on, and it may be possible that our research instrument might have come to you for responding. I don't know. Development of framework and strategies for sustenance of autonomy in polytechnics and engineering colleges with respect to aspects of institutional autonomy. A research study on impact of faculty development programs on performance of teachers of technical institutions in India. Development of communication skills through language laboratory and its effect on employability of technical graduates. Comparative study of accreditation criteria and processes in selected Washington Accord signatory countries. This is international level study. Impact study of adopted assessment schemes and credits on the performance of engineering graduates of programs offered in premier institutes in India. Impact of accreditation on performance of the faculty and students in the engineering colleges. Effectiveness of e-content in terms of learning outcomes of technical teachers. Augmenting employability skills through academia industry symbiosis and accreditation perspective. Critical study of ICT adoption in technical education of Washington region. Again, it is international level study. Then effect of private players' investment in technical education in India and impact analysis. Impact of scheme of community development through polytechnics on employment and social equity in the western region of India. Evolve an outcome-based blended mode technical teacher training program. Expansion of higher education in India and the task of inclusive economic growth. Polytechnic students' personal and institutional variables as predictors of their learning outcomes, a predictive analysis of mined data. Teaching learning strategy for entrepreneurship incubation and startup in India. A comparative study skills qualification framework systems in education and training of Germany, Australia, South Korea, and India. Again, this is international study. Then critical study of immersive learning for skill development in selected sectors of national skills qualification framework in India. So these are the 17 topics on which we are currently working. And as a dean, I am having near about 37 topics which will be scrutinized by the national level committee. And we will support, means in the coming session, we will support maybe another 20 research studies. So this is how we promote the research culture, and at the same time, we involve the practitioners which are working in real life situation. So thank you very much. That is what I wanted to share with you. And I think time is available with us. So I would be happy to respond to your questions. Dear friends, in my presentation, I have not touched the theory. I have simply used the application of the theory related to research studies in technical education and in higher education. So, dear friends, thank you very much. Now, I welcome your questions, clarifications, and maybe your experiences related to researches in technical and higher education. Thank you.
Right, sir. We have a few questions here, sir. One of the questions is that in PRESER study, individuals or samples are studied again at different stages in their lives. So are these studies relevant in management? If yes, sir.
Definitely. Suppose Gita Ratan Institute has produced, say, 2,000 graduates, management graduates. So where are they working? What is their profile? What are their accomplishments? What innovations they have implemented? How the education you imparted was relevant to grow in their career like that, to deal with the real life situation? So this tracer study would be helpful to re-engineer your complete curriculum design, curriculum implementation, and even the certification of abilities. So yeah, it's very useful. We should do it. Every 5 years, we should do it.
We have one participant joining, sir. But in the meanwhile, can we take another question? It's like, sure, how can we integrate blended learning and project-based learning, like you have been talking about project-based learning in the beginning?
Yeah. Nowadays, for some disciplines, there are international websites which provides opportunity for doing online projects also. So they assign the problems to the students or maybe teachers or maybe interested persons. So you can take up those problems and you can work on that. So in this way, you can do it. And there are a number of platforms where you can share, work on a particular project on a sharing basis also. If we talk about our country, AICT has introduced very good innovation for last 2-3 years, that is hackathon, and under that there is a collaboration with the industry and educational institutions, and industrial problems are selected by a panel of experts. And these problems are assigned to the students and they work on real life problems. And this is how they get the guidance from the industry, maybe through net or maybe through means indirect means. And at the same time, they are receiving the guidance of the teacher. And this is how the project-based learning incorporated the concept of ICT and all that. So again, it all depends on your creativity and your skills as a teacher and the culture in the institute. Culture in the institute is very, very important. Otherwise, in typical institutions, so many bureaucratic processes, so many ifs and buts, there it is not possible.
Right. We have another question, sir. Like many of the PhD scholars are facing this problem when they, you know, when they finalize their topic, they find it very difficult to find out, you know, to explore the research papers which are good enough or worthy enough to be incorporated in their research design, in their research. So what is the process, do you suggest, that they can search on good quality research papers, and what are the parameters of finding out that these are good quality research papers to be, you know, used for the research?
Okay. If you are doing experimental research, then you should make it a criterion, primary essential criterion, that you will consider only a paper based on experimental research. You will not consider any other paper. Since it is a PhD research, so it should not be, the paper should not be reviewed. No, we should not select the papers casually. So what type of research you are undertaking, that type of papers based on that type of research study should be taken. Even if they are 50 papers and they are quality papers, they will serve the purpose, because those 50 papers will lay the foundation for selecting the title, for formulating the research objectives, for formulating the hypothesis, for delimiting the study, for designing the instrument or adopting the instrument, for using the statistics for testing the hypothesis, for drawing the inferences and conclusions, for writing the recommendations. So you can interview their findings, means you can compare their findings with your findings, and in this way you can come out with the substantial new body of knowledge, and you may very easily get PhD. So it's not number which matters, but it's the quality of papers which matters. I have seen in many, many studies, people try to review each and every type of thing, whether it is authentic or not, whether it is based on the research or not, like that. So it should not be the practice. Even 50 papers, good quality papers are there, it is sufficient for me, no issue. No issue. And because of this internet facility, nowadays papers are available, maybe on payment basis. I am also paying for many papers and purchasing the papers, since I want to base my work on that authenticated work. So I also purchase. It's like that.
Sir,
so,
there is a question. How to engage? How to engage students to distribute the PhD work in effective way?
How to engage
students to distribute the PhD work in effective way? I think Professor Sumit Ramesh Thakur, he may be a professor, and the question he has put forward: how to engage students to distribute PhD work in effective way?
You just ask professor to come online and ask this question. Can you do that?
There is no answer from this side.
Okay, fine. Actually, I am not a PhD guide. I don't take up PhD related research. Only I have produced 4-5 candidates, PhDs. And I take people who are having more than 25 years experience. So I don't have that experience. But my humble submission is that the synopsis or PhD proposal should be so strong and substantiated with evidences, and should be able to see the end of the research work. If you are able to do that, I think there is lesser risk.
Okay, sir. Okay. Geeta Daspana ma'am has provided a question. Is the data called valid which is collected by Google questionnaire during the pandemic period? If any data collected through Google questionnaire, will that be treated as valid?
Yeah, again it depends on the topic, but there is a concept of recency. So suppose you are mailing me an instrument related to stress, definitely the concept of recency will come in picture, and I will respond to that particular instrument based on my recent experiences. So it may be a biased study. So again, it depends on the title. What type of title you are researching? If the situation is independent with the type of environment, then there is no problem. But if it is on, say, fatigue or stress or frustration or demotivation or satisfaction or energy level, definitely it will be a biased study. And this is a very short time means problem. So on such topics, we should not collect data, whether it is through Google form or through email or even maybe in person. We should not do that.
Okay.
For such type of titles, we should not collect data at this point of time.
Sir, there is another question from Dr. Ace Jamuna.
Ji.
She has, I don't know, he or she. Sir, though a person is good in research, ultimately money decides the publication.
Ji.
Ultimately money decides the publication. How can you guide the poor faculty members, especially self-financing faculty members, for publication?
No, there are number of journals. If your paper is of best quality, they don't charge. There are number of journals which accept free, but it may take say 6 months time or 1 year time. But your paper should be quality paper. What I have done, I want to share my experience in response to this question. What I have done recently, I have conducted one step study on technical education system in Gujarat and Madhya Pradesh. And I communicated that paper in the international journal. So immediately, I received a comment that this paper is not good for international journal because it is not giving anything new to the international audience. So suppose my study is confined to a particular state or institute, and if I try to publish the paper in international journal, definitely nobody is going to accept. Except those who charge for it.
Right, sir.
It's like that.
Right, sir. There is another question from Dr. Avindita Chakraborty. She asks the question, how to select the topic of research proposal for funding organization? I say from funding organization. How to select a topic?
You want to receive some grant for doing the research project.
Yeah. So yeah. Our question is, what will be the topic?
No, for that choice is not yours. Choice is of the sponsoring agency or funding agency. So whenever they announce, whether it is DST or AICT or any professional body or funding body or even NGOs, generally they provide the guideline. So under their guideline, you have to choose the topic and you have to prepare the proposal and you have to submit it.
Right.
I was talking about this 7 research studies. It's lighter side. We prepared this 17 research proposals in the format of AICT. We approached to AICT. They said we don't encourage research studies in technical education. We don't have any provision. After that, we went to ministry. Ministry said that we are already funding you. You can manage it with your funds. After that, we went to planning commission. Planning commission told us that we don't have provision for conducting research studies of this kind. So what I want to submit that if you follow their guidelines and procedures and formats, you can easily get. But they will not fund your research studies.
Right, sir. Sir, Dr. Umar Gulati has put up a question. Teachers have to report their publication in their ACR. But if free journal takes more than 1 year and paid journals are high fee, how a faculty balance between two?
If the paper is accepted, I think it is being considered by the organization. In my institute, we do that.
Okay.
So paper may come after 1.5 years, no issue. But I should have acceptance letter.
Okay. A question from Dr. Rajesh Pingavil. Sir, what are the ethical considerations in research?
Sorry?
What are the ethical considerations in research? Ethical. Yeah.
If you follow systematic and scientific approach, then ethics will not come in between. But if you camouflage the information, if you use the wrong statistics to project something favorable, or if you don't consider the data which have significance in drawing inferences, or if you use inappropriate methodology or weak methodology, all these are violating professional ethics. So the very, very simple answer to this is we should follow systematic and scientific approach for conducting the research study. So when we follow the systematic and scientific approach, we take care of validity, reliability, again in validity, content validity, methodology validity, statistical validity. So everything, when we talk about sampling, so we use this system, means we use the proper process of taking out the sample. So in this way, if you follow the systematic approach, I think ethics will not come in between.
Sir, one ethic related question now comes as a question. Dr. Kamal Bhardwaj, can we go for republish a paper which was published in a non-UGC Calist journal?
No. I have seen one professor, it's lighter side, huh? I have seen one professor, his promotion was due. So what he did, he prepared one very good paper based on the primary data. After that, he did creativity. And this is the era of computer and we have soft copy. So he simply changed the titles, that's it. Rest of the paper was same. And he mailed it to 15 journals. And in 7-6 journals it was published. So should we do like this? We should not. It is publication for the sake of publication. It is not going to serve any purpose. And it is unethical also. But there is a practice that many people write that this paper was presented in the conference. And this is the modified version, or this is the paper which incorporated the review comments and it is being republished again. like that. Or they also mention sometimes that it is based on those data, but in present context, like that. So if something fresh, new body of knowledge is there with different perspective, 30-40% things will remain same. But 70% things are different, different perspective, different knowledge, different analysis, different conclusion. Yes, you can do it. But sir, same thing should not be published.
Right. Sir, one question came from Dr. Madhava. His question is, sir, how can I prepare a good funding project proposal in accounting and management? And what are the funding agencies in these areas?
I am afraid, actually, I am not from this field.
Right.
So, I am not the right person to...
Right. So, sir, with these words, like, any concluding remarks anybody would like to say? The participants? Any other questions you have?
I think all the questions are now...
All the questions have been answered very properly. And we have learned a lot from and also how to integrate research into our as a pedagogical tool in our teaching. Also, you know, people are inspired that they have learned that these are the various ways of doing research. So, sir, with these words, I'd like to say a great heartfelt thank you to you, sir. Thanks for accepting our invite and sparing your valuable time and, you know, enlightening our participants. Thank you so much, sir. And dear participants, we'll be ending this discussion today here only. We'll see you tomorrow. We will have another very interesting session lined up for you tomorrow. So see you tomorrow. Thank you.